Welcome to this edition of Christian Connection. So glad to have you in the Loma Linda Broadcasting Network studios. Today we've got quite a program. Sheila's here. So is Dr. Taylor and a returning friend, Mark Etchell. He's the pastor of the Loma Linda Campus Hill Church. Mm-hmm. It's the one on the hill. Welcome. What are you going to be speaking on this evening?
Well, I'm going to talk about how sometimes we think things happen and people say the world will never be the same place. It'll never be the same after this. Mm. And how there's only a few things in Earth's history that we can say that's actually true.
Wow. Really pertinent for these times, these days, and these hours. Right after music, we will go to that story by Mark Etchell, and he's going to educate us tonight, I can just tell. Sheila, what do we have for music?
Well, I'm really excited. One of our favorite special guests, Lukey and Liam Thomas, will be blessing us with their beautiful composition of Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us. Thank you, Lukey and Liam.
Thank you. Wasn't that wonderful? These are probably about the youngest performers we had on LLBN. Praise God. A six-year-old and a 7 years old. That's amazing.
I would take you to task for one thing. They're not performers. They're ministers of music.
Amen. Amen. Well said. Well, hello, folks, and I'm so glad that you're able to join us for another Christian Connections Live that comes to you every Tuesday evening and repeats throughout the week in many places on our channels. You know, when I was about their age, when I was a kid, I heard so much stories of Christ's second return and the signs of the last days, and I've always been intrigued by that. I find myself, even till this year, that subscribing to international news channels just to see what's going on around the world. And it's really sad to see what's going on around the world, the devastations, the loss of lives, the natural disasters that devastating many communities, the political friction between countries, the increase in military power and nuclear power around the world. It's just really crazy. But I can't help thinking about the last days. But I have to admit, when I watch all these commotions taking place, I take myself into deep search in my heart, in my soul. What should I expect? What's going to happen now or 10 years from now or 100 years from now, which I will not be alive by then? But we have that desire to have Jesus come and like to believe these are the last days that we're living in, and we could very well be. But it always comes back to asking myself, Gannon, without Jesus, you're lost. You're just dust in the wind. But with Jesus, I'm far more than that. I'm a precious soul anchored by his mercy and grace. And I have a job here on this earth to share his good news with others in every way and capacity we can, including through the airways of LLBN. I know that's your passion too, and every believer passion to bring as many souls we can to his kingdom. So I'm going to pause here and leave the rest of it to Marlon and the rest of the group to listen to today's message and to be engaged in a discussion among ourselves. Marlon?
Well, thank you, Gannon. Why don't you have a seat? Be comfortable.
Thank you.
Because we have a Bible-preaching preacher. His name is Mark Etchell. That's a clue for you to have your Bibles handy. In fact, why don't you just begin by opening it to the book of Romans, and we'll see what the book has to say and what Pastor Mark has to say about that verse in the book. Let's go.
All right.
The day that changed the world.
The day that changed the world.
Pastor Mark Etchell.
Thank you. Get situated here. Yeah, open your Bibles to Romans chapter 15. We'll spend most of our time there. We will hop around a few other places. I've got a question. There are dates that have changed the world, or so people have said. In fact, sometimes when there are some things happening that are disastrous, people say the world will never be the same. And as we just passed 20-year anniversary of 9/11, I heard people saying that, you know, the world has never been the same. And really, I want you to look for the 4 points in this sermon. There are 4 days in Earth's history for you that make it so the world will never be the same, but it's not what you think. In fact, as we were looking at some of the news shows on 9/11, there was one woman being profiled about her husband who was a fireman and how when he didn't come home, she wondered what was happening. She had a brother-in-law who's a fireman, and so she went with him to Ground Zero, where the towers had stood, and when she saw the devastation, something spoke in her, and she said, if he was alive, he would have contacted me, and just being there, she said, she knew he was gone. And she had to go home and tell her kids, for us, the world is not going to be the same. And that's happened to many of us. If we have faced disease, we've had an untimely death in our family, accident, disease, or something else. We have a family member one time who was in a shopping mall and just in a place where somebody shot and killed her. And it's like the world wasn't the same for a family, but what does that mean? Well, I'm going to ask you a question. If you can look at this picture, can anybody tell me what this is? Of course you can. This is 9/11/2001, and here you can see a little more. You can see people running. You can see the first responders with the rubble behind, and here you can see the devastation of that day when 3,000 people died. And did the world change on that day? Maybe yes, maybe no. I've looked at other things in history. I'm going to see if I can get our people here on front. Can you tell me what this is?
Pearl Harbor.
Pearl Harbor. And I would have to ask, is there anybody here remembers Pearl Harbor? Dr. Taylor, I was thinking you would. I asked that in my church at Campus Hill, and we have quite a few people in Campus Hill who are immigrants, and many of them had no clue what this was, and many of them are young, and so you have to be in your 80s now to be able to remember that. How about this one? This is a little closer to home. Anybody remember this? This is when John F. Kennedy was shot, and this is his son who is saluting as his father's casket goes by. And the sad thing is this little boy became a man, and he died in an airplane crash that he was piloting. What about this? This one was in my day. This guy's name is James Meredith, and on June 6, 1966, he didn't want to be part of the marches for freedom in the South, and so he decided he would do his own march, and as he's walking along, a white supremacist in the bushes shot him with a shotgun 3 times, and I remember seeing this picture in the paper. I believe it was June 6, 1966, and it made an impact on me. What kind of a person would do this to another human being? Well, the interesting thing is I never knew it happened. So as I was looking this up, James got up, received first aid. The pellets were still in his back, and he finished his 100-mile walk for civil rights. Now, here's one that some of us here in Loma Linda who know Ralph Watts Jr., he was part of this, and he has a presentation called Last Flight Out or Last Plane Out. I don't know, have you had that here on this program? But this was an incredible thing, and we have seen something like this even recently in Afghanistan. But I remember when this happened, I was at Pacific Union College up in Napa Valley in 1975. And then I come to this, and this has real importance for our family because my wife's mother's family escaped from East Germany some years before the wall was built, and so many of our family were in East Germany, and we never could visit. And on this day, in fact, I want to make sure I get the date right. On this day, November 9, 1989, the Berlin Wall fell. And this is one where people around the world were affected, so a lot of people would know what's happening here. And for us, it was a chance to go back. We've been back to Germany numerous times since then and got reconnected with the family. And then here's one with the Romanians in our church. I thought I would make sure I put this one up because this is interesting. This guy was a dictator in Romania, Ceausescu. And he on the 23rd of December, which was just after the Berlin Wall fell, about a month, decided he wasn't going to go along with the changes. And as he was being threatened, he had his soldiers turn their guns on his own people. And he was literally chased out of a speech. He was chased into a helicopter. The military landed the helicopter. They took him into a very small tribunal with some officers, and he and his wife were shot on the spot. And for Romanians, that was a big day because it was out from under the thumb of a person who's a dictator. So, last but not least, does anybody remember this? 2004. In about 5 months' time, over 1 million Rwandans were killed. And the thing that is so sad about this, this is pictures of refugees, is that most Rwandans were Christians of one sort or another, but there were even Seventh-day Adventists, which is our faith, pastors who were involved in the genocide and who had to be held accountable for what they had done. And their Christianity did not surpass their tribal allegiances. And here's a picture. You can see these boys. Their mothers got across the border into Burundi. The border was shut, and they are wanting to be with their mom, and they're on the other side of the closure. And when we look at all of this, we think, where were you when all this stuff happened? Where were you on any of these days? And I'd like for us to think of four things, and we're going to have to run really quick here. And I'm just going to read the Bible off of my notes, so I'm not turning to it, and you're going to have to be really quick with this. But there are pundits after all sorts of events that say the world will never be the same, and yet really there are four times where the world is not the same. And the first one, you can see the picture here. The first one is when, The first one was when sin entered. In Romans chapter 5, verse 12, let's read it together. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people because all sinned. Now, the important thing about this particular passage, it reminds us one of the significant events in the world's history which would change the world for a time was the entrance of sin. Did it change the world forever? No. See, that's the best thing about God. He hatched a plan. It says the plan that was laid before the foundation of the world. God knew that someone at some point in time would go against his government, and he already had a plan that was laid out from the beginning. And I like the way one commentator put it. He said, God has a plan, and the only thing that we have is interruptions to his plan, and the biggest interruption to his plan for all eternity was sin. But still, it's an interruption. And so when we look at this interruption, look at the first one. When sin entered, something happened. And I like what is said in Ephesians 6, verses 10 and 11. From that point on, Paul says, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places. So from that day on, we have all had this propensity, this tendency to sin. We inherited that from Adam. But even at the beginning, Genesis 3:15, we're not going to go into it, but there's a promise God said that someone would come that would crush the serpent's head. Who's the serpent? Revelation says the ancient serpent, who is the devil and Satan. So the first event that could be considered a world-changing event is when sin entered. The second event started in Gethsemane, where Jesus is saying to his father, Father, if I don't want to drink this cup of affliction, but nevertheless, if there's no other way, thy will, not mine, be done. And as a result of that, Jesus took our sins and bore them on a tree. In fact, Romans 5:15, staying in Romans, says, but the gift is not like the trespass, for if the many died by the trespass of the one man, how much more? And I love when Paul says that what Jesus did is abundant. What does abundant mean? If you were to ask Ganem here, Ganem, what would abundant funds mean as you're in a remodel?
I can't even quantify it.
You can't quantify it. Because abundant funds essentially is saying we have everything we need and more. And this is what is said here. The gift is not like the trespass, for if the many died by the trespass of the one, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many? Wouldn't we like to have funds to overflow in ministries, to overflow in our personal budgets, to overflow in our churches? Romans 5:19 agrees. For just as through the disobedience of the one man, the many were made sinners, so through the obedience of the one man, the many will be made righteous. And that we could unpack in a sermon just itself. I like the way Peter says it in 1 Peter 2:25. It says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his stripes you have been healed. So where were we on the day Jesus died? Now, we weren't anywhere even thought of on the day that sin entered, but where were we on the day Jesus died? We are part of that story. Why? Because when Jesus took our sins, we were with him on the cross. In fact, it wasn't the cross that killed him. It was the weight of the sins of the world, the weight of the Father turning his face away and Jesus saying, why have you forsaken me? See, no one has ever been forsaken by God yet except for Jesus. Even the devil has not been forsaken by God, but there'll come a point in time where the Lord can be called on and he won't answer because time is over. The third thing, okay, when sin entered, where were you? You were not even thought of, but that impacted the world in its own interruption. Where were you when Jesus died? You were with him on the cross. Now, here's the important part. If you have not done something with Jesus' death for you on the cross, if you haven't accepted him, then really eternity doesn't matter to you. Because I do not believe that there's an ever-burning hell where people who are Christians will be able to look through the cracks in the ground and see their relatives being tortured. And that's a whole nother subject as to why a person would even have that kind of belief. And we who don't believe that have to be careful sometimes. We don't use the second coming as scare tactics to scare people into relationship with Christ. Because we don't have a hell to scare people into relationship with Christ. We say, the close of probation is coming, be careful, because who knows, you might not be ready. And so we're scaring people rather than saying, come to Christ, have a loving relationship, he'll live in your heart, he'll declare you righteous, and he'll live in you, and he'll will and do of his pleasure. When you accepted Christ, I thought I'd show some pictures here. Individual being baptized. Do you remember your baptism? Do you remember where you were doing? I remember I was in Northern California in the Russian River, and the day was 103 degrees, and I was baptized by Neil C. Wilson Sr. We had a little tiny church, and Ted Wilson's grandfather was our retired pastor. And I remember it being so hot that I was in the river finding a place where I could dog paddle around and stay cool until it was my turn to be baptized. And that's not all that happened, because I did give my heart to the Lord, but I didn't come out as this individual did. I have baptized people who have jumped out of the water. Praise the Lord! This is amazing. Thank you, Jesus, for forgiveness of sins. One man who was a drug addict and a drug pusher thought he would never, ever live to see his life transformed, and God transformed him. And he literally did that, ponytail and all. Praise you, God. I was more of one of those kids, you know, you're baptized because your friends are. And God had to re-baptize me with his Spirit later on. But this is the next part of that verse. Romans 6, 1 to 4. What shall we say then? So shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Don't you know that all of us who are baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ Jesus was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. So what happened in this third part is we have accepted Christ's death on our behalf, and we've said, I want to have a daily walk. And you can see here in this picture of a young one who's walking with God. You can see someone on a beach walking with God. You can see The disciples, who, if you remember, as Jesus is getting ready to ascend into heaven, they're not wanting to say goodbye. At the end of the book of John, Peter is wondering what's going to happen to him. He's denied Jesus three times, and three times Jesus said, "Peter, do you love me?" Three times Peter says, "You know I do, Lord. Then feed my sheep." Three times. Jesus allowed him to redeem his mistake by proving three times with affirmation that he loved Jesus. So, let's look at the list here. Where were you when sin entered? You weren't there. Where were you when Jesus died? You were on his mind. You were on his heart. Your sins were on him. And when you accepted Christ, that became a significant day. See, when Jesus died, that was part of the end of the interruption of sin. When you accepted Christ, the interruption of sin in your life changed and made something different for you. In fact, there's a paradox. Do you realize that there are dead people walking and live people in the grave? What does that mean? Look at this for a second. When we are dead in our sins, we may be around walking and living life and driving our car and going and buying groceries and working, but if Jesus came and we haven't accepted him, we are dead in our sins. We have others who are sleeping in the dust of the grave, who if Jesus came, they will wake. So there is this paradox. There are people sleeping in the dust, the first death, who actually are closer to eternal life than those who are walking around. Isn't that a strange paradox? But this is where the fourth part comes in. When Jesus returns, that one day that makes all the difference in the world, Jesus dying for our sins, will come to fruition on this day. Because the Bible says, many will say on that day, "Lord, Lord, look at all the good things we've done." And he says, "Depart from me, I never knew you." Matthew 25 says that Jesus will say to the sheep, "Man, you took care of me. I was hungry, you fed me. I was thirsty, you gave me to drink. I was naked, you clothed me. I was a stranger, you took me in." All these things. And the sheep say, "When did we do that?" And Jesus said, "If you did it least of these, you did it to me." And then he says to the goats, "You're going to go where there's a wailing and gnashing of teeth because you didn't do it. Well, we never saw you." And he said, "Because you didn't do it to the least of these, you didn't do it to me." Where were you when Adam and Eve sinned? Where were you when Jesus died? Where were you when you accepted Christ and have had that daily walk? And where will you be when Jesus returns? The only day that has eternal significance is Jesus' death on the cross. The rest are interruptions. You can choose to be part of that day. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. The wrestling took place before the flood. The wrestling took place through the Old Testament when people turned away from God. The wrestling continued with Jesus as a second Adam to redeem Adam's failure. The wrestling continued as he took our sins. The wrestling continues to this day as we see wars, famines, earthquakes, pestilences, people hurting other people. The wrestling has continued since Adam and Eve, but it's only temporary. There's one day that changed the world forever, and that's the day that Jesus solved the sin problem. Miracle of miracles is this. The devil tried to make a breach in God's relationship with man, and he did a good job of it. When God walked with Adam and Eve in the garden, Adam and Eve sinned, there was a breach in that. But when Jesus became one of us to save us, there became a bond with him that's tighter than ever would have been. So in the end, we aren't going to go, "Well, look how special we are because of Jesus. He's now our brother." We're going to have a love for him that probably no one else understands because we've seen the evils of sin. We've walked through it, and yet we remain committed to Christ. Genesis 50:20 has a statement that Joseph made when his brothers tried to get rid of him, and in the end it all worked out. And he said to them, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what's being done." You know, there is a day that changed the world forever. Jesus dying for you. And there's a day that can change the world for you forever, and that is today, saying to him, "Have your way, Lord." C.S. Lewis had a great statement that I've said many times, maybe even here in the past. There's only two type of people in the world. Only two type in the end. Those that say to God, "Have your way in my life, and thy will be done." And those who God says, "Okay then, have it your way." May we choose to say to God, "Have your own way in my life." I'm going to leave that there.
Thank you, Pastor. Appreciate your message.
Mm-hmm.
The day that changed the world. But there's 4 days, so it's not the day.
There's one that changed for eternity, yeah, for the world. The other were interruptions. The one day that everybody can look back to and say, because of that day, my whole outlook has changed. And that's in the context of people wringing their hands and going, "Oh, the world will never be the same. Look what happened. The world will never be the..." You know, in your and my life, we can see things that happen. We're going to go, "It'll never be the same." And time goes by, and we learn to live without someone we depended on.
Out of those 4 days, though, when has the world ever been the same? I mean, it's changing every day.
But it's all the same. Sin is in dominion for right now. Yeah. And there's different faces of sin. There's different things that happen. There's different things that change. But still, the sin problem covers all of this stuff. It's like an artist's canvas. And all the paint colors are there, and the canvas keeps changing pictures, but it's still sin. And we look forward to the day for the culmination of all things where that will be gone.
Well, I really appreciate your analogy of getting married, you know, is the big change in your day, or when Ganem had his first child. Well, your wife had his, but you were there. I mean, that day changed your world.
It sure did, and it did again on the second, and then on the third child. But as the pastor said, there's really one day that really changed my life, changed the life of my wife, changed the life of my kids, and those who I'm surrounded by, which is accepting Christ. As Jesus not died for us and learned about his ultimate plan of salvation, we'd have been all dust in the wind.
And think about it. Even the best of us, the healthiest of us, lives to what, 110? And then it's done. Unless you have accepted Christ, it's just a matter of length. In fact, that's the interesting thing about any creature. If you're a fruit fly, you live for 13 days, and you're here, and you're gone. If you're a person without eternal life, you live here for 13 years, 110 years, you know, 900 years, the antediluvian world, and the end is the same.
Yeah.
You have a beginning, you have an end. For a Christian, we have a beginning and no end.
What's all the goal in all this, Sheila?
Well, I think the goal is really just being grateful for that day that Jesus came. I think the moment we believe is the moment we have life, true life.
Yeah.
You know, so when Jesus died for us, it was not what we've done, but what he did for us.
But that's really our goal, is to get to know Jesus better.
Absolutely.
So that we can partake of that abundant life that he so freely gives us.
Yeah, it's about choosing that, yes.
Yeah.
And one of the things I mentioned, I did a similar sermon this last Sabbath, and I had a little more time, so I developed the thought of Romans 8:28 says, in all things God works for the good of those who love him, for those who are called according to his purpose. When you don't know Christ and something bad happens, the initial reaction is, why me? Why is this happening to me? And I find Christians all the time who have that attitude. Why is this happening to me? What have I ever done? Well, guess what? You live in a sinful world, and you have genetics, and you have accidents, and you have people whose cruelty can cause effects down the line. You have your own relatives who have patterns in the family and DNA. And yet, Romans 8:28 says, when something happens, the Christian shouldn't be saying, why me? They should come to God and say, okay, what now? Yeah. What now? What now? You've said you're going to work good out of this. What now? Open my eyes to see. And I have thought for years, and I've talked to people, what if we get to eternity? And on a day in heaven, or on the new earth, Jesus says, Marlon, do you remember you had the question of why that happened in your life? I have sent out a text message to everybody that was involved in that problem. And we're all meeting by the sea of glass on the sandy beach. And you get there and there's 350 people. And you go, well, how did that affect them? And he goes, well, let them tell you. And each person could trace back where the ripples of that one thing affected them. And here you were thinking it was about you, and it wasn't. God said, I could have solved the problem, but it would have kept all these people from growing through this, and they may not have been here.
So that's why he tells us, you know, my thoughts are higher than your thoughts.
Isaiah 55.
Right? Yep. And rejoice in all things, you know, because he's only got good in mind for us. He never has evil, does he, Dr. Taylor?
Well, really. And as I listened, his four points he gave, being a preacher like he is, but not quite as good as he, I would have said, what? Adam, Eve, the fall. So what we see today, 9-1-1, things that are happening.
Yeah.
What, now what, so what? That's where I go to the cross. And that's where Jesus gives me the power. And that's what it's all about. And this is why I emphasize not so much being the Christian, because I listened the other day to leadership saying, we're going to get those Afghanis who killed these 13 soldiers of ours. We're going to get even. I don't hear Christ-like followers saying that. Father, forgive, for they know not what they do. They don't know you. You died for the world.
It's kind of like speaking like a dragon, huh?
Speaking like a dragon.
Right.
So what, now what, so what will I do? We here at the Christian Connection, what it means, what we share, the good news that Jesus died. And we had that promise in Genesis, the book of beginnings, genetics.
Amen.
The serpent, he's going to bruise the heel, but you're going to bruise his head. And I often smiled when they would see rattlesnakes in my day. They would take their guns and shoot. They said, boy, he's straight. He shot that snake right in the head. I said, no. That snake is so fast, he sees the bullet, he strikes the bullet, and the bullet kills him. Jesus, the head, crushed. Victory is ours.
Yeah, thank you for that. I think that's a great analogy.
Amen.
You know, the pastor was talking about many things, and one of the things he said was, it's all about the relationship. You know, and he mentioned that those who do not know Jesus, and something bad happens to them, they don't have a rock, they don't have anchor to grasp on. Can you imagine what that must feel like?
I certainly can. You know, sometimes I used to worry, like you said, you know, there was always this fear. You got to turn Adventist because, you know, you want to be saved. You know, it was that fear tactic until I took that study. You know, when you start reading the Bible, just learning, and you know, you said it's about a daily walk in relationship with Jesus. Mm-hmm. That that doesn't make you fear. Makes you trust Him. Mm-hmm. That no matter what happens, that you trust Him. That He's got you. You know.
Yeah.
Like Dr. Taylor said, He gives you the power. Ever since Christ died on the cross, we have power because of Him.
So the cross was the victory. And Gannon, why is the usurper still around?
Why what?
The usurper, Lucifer. He's lost, right? He's done for. There's his probation is essentially closed. Is that correct, Dr. Taylor?
Yeah, when there's a book called Desire of Ages, when you read it, it says that when Christ was crucified on the cross, that's when Satan's doom was sealed and those angels who fell with him. So the cross, the power, they're doomed. But see, Satan is smart. Persecute you. Got them. Persecute. I'm going to pray more. I'm going to turn to Jesus. But he's very subtle. He gets us in other ways. Not just persecution. He fools us.
What about that, Gannon?
My thinking, I'm sure there are many other questions and thoughts on this topic, but it just shows even how just God is by allowing even Satan to dwell on earth and to let him finish his work. And through that, I think Satan will reveal himself and his wickedness to many, and many will become believer. If Satan was not let loose, I think our hearts are wicked anyway, and we'd probably be causing problems ourselves. But it's a good question. I think, again, back to God's just. He doesn't destroy. He wait and let justice happen in the right time, in the right place. And we know Satan will be eliminated at the end.
And do remember that Jesus said that it's not how bad the world gets. We spoke about this in the past. It's not how bad the world gets that says this is when time is up. Matthew 24:14 says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to the whole world, and then the end shall come. See, it's God's long-suffering nature to allow people to make the choice.
Yeah.
And so he has actually partnered with his church. And his church is Christianity. And I believe that our view of Christianity has something to say. And if we get bogged down to some of the minor things that don't have to do with major issues, and believe me, you after being a pastor, I'm in 42 years now. The amount of things that people can get sidelined with that have nothing to do with a relationship with Christ. If we could do what, again, this comes from Ministry of Healing, Ellen White. It's pretty much the same as Jesus says. Christ's method alone will reach people. He mingled with people as one who desired their good. And after he had met their needs and won their confidence, he bid them, follow me. And so if we could mingle with people and share with them the advantages of having a relationship with Christ, not the club rules. You know, you have to be like this in order to be in relationship with God. Just all you have to do is say, God, have your way. Have your way with me.
And it sounds so simple. You know, we hear these theological terms, justification, sanctification, glorification, the justification, just as if I had not sinned.
Yep.
Then we get caught up, well, how long does that take? And that's a good discussion, and we can look at that.
How about a twinkling in the eye?
And when your eye twinkles, you don't even lose sight.
That's right.
When it twinkles.
Yeah.
When you wink, you lose sight.
Yeah.
But not when it twinkles.
That's a good thing you're just twinkling all the time.
That's right.
And I like the sanctification, because what does to sanctify something mean? To set it apart for a holy use. And yet, many times as Christians, we say sanctification is becoming holy, not being a receptacle for God's holiness to the world, but getting rid of these sins in my life.
Okay, good place to pick up right after some great musical ministry. And
yes.
Here's Sheila with all the information you need.
Yeah. Well, we're so grateful that Liam Thomas will be providing this wonderful musical ministry in song, and he's going to be playing Great is the Lord.
Oh, beautiful.
Thomas, what we need to do on the next edition of Christian Connections, or whenever Jamie George can make it, we need to get those guys together to do a duet right here on the program. What do you think? Mm-hmm. Jamie, are you watching? Give Daryl a call. He's waiting. All right. This is really, really exciting to see, like as you mentioned, ministers of music in action and doing the work. You know, this is a great way for people to be introduced to Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. We need to get them in your church to do special music when the church opens back up.
But did you notice the focus in that song? Great is the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And
that's where the key is that unlocks the door to real freedom. Great is the Lord.
And the Lord is certainly great. You know, we were talking about sanctification and justification just before we took the break, and I think that's a pretty good course to pursue. So you want to continue, Pastor Mark?
We human beings like litmus tests, and we like graphs and plotting a graph to see where we are and what we're doing. And I think when we read in the Gospels, we find out that Jesus said, "Accept your righteousness, exceed those that do the plotting and the you know, where am I in all this?" And if you have read any of the Talmud, Mishnah, some of the things and the rules and the laws were just unbelievably strict. In fact, I had a friend who pastored a church in California, and he was only there like 6 months, and I said, "How's it going?" And he rolled his eyes and says, "Oh my." I said, "What?" And I said, "Just explain to me." He goes, "Well, let me just explain my church." He said, "If we would have a movie night in our gymnasium, and we could agree on a film, and we had popcorn, you'd have people that said the only way to eat popcorn is popcorn with no salt. But then there's a group that say, no, you need to have popcorn with salt. And the other people say, no, you have to have popcorn with butter and salt. And then some that say only popcorn with butter. And then some that say popcorns with brewer's yeast, because that's whatever, healthy." And he says, and all of these people on all of this minor thing about popcorn could make it into a huge issue. And I was asked to speak for a church's retreat one time. And as I knew the church very well, and I spoke with the people, they said, "Why is it that we have a hard time keeping people?" And I said, "Do you really want to know the truth? Or are you just asking me? We really want to know the truth." They said, "You know how you have a long hallway coming in the back?" I said, "It is as though every one of you has a hula hoop. And some are bigger, some are smaller, pink, orange, whatever. And that's your hula hoop. And you all space yourselves out, and you hold it at different heights. And you tell the person, if you can make it through all of our hoops, you can become one of us." And I said, and by the time they've tried the fifth one, they say, "This is too much work." And so we need to throw that away and say, "God, if we introduce people to you, you are big enough to bring up to them what they need to work on in their life. They don't have to please us, they have to please you."
Very difficult question, because who made the rules in the Talmud? You know, the church. You know, the leadership made those rules, and we have similar. You know, we have 28 fundamentals that you have to adhere to. Not that those are wrong or that we shouldn't have them, and they're really great signposts.
But you can make them the be all and end all. Hmm. For example, we believe the Ten Commandments are important. And yet I have seen probably within Adventism the most abused commandment is the Fourth Commandment. You need to keep the Sabbath the way I think you need to keep the Sabbath, or you're not a true Christian. Mm. I'm going, wait a minute.
But that's not what the commandment says.
That's not what the commandment says.
No.
Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy.
Yeah.
And
so you remember. And I remember, and you remember, it's not my way, it's not your way, it's Christ's way.
So I have a question. A friend of mine was a missionary in East Africa. I think we talked about this once. And he took his flippers and his mask, and he headed down to the Indian Ocean. And people were coming out of their house, and they had their binoculars, their bird book. They said, where are you going? He said, why? Well, you have mask and flippers. And he said, where are you going? And they said, we're bird watching. And he smiled and said, I'm going fish watching. But they judged him because getting in the water is a sin. Past your knees. You can wade in it.
Yeah.
And that's the kind of stuff where, you know, I think back of my parents. I grew up next to a river in Northern California, and it gets to be 110 degrees. And I remember on Sabbath afternoons, my parents saying, don't jump off the rocks to where you could get hurt and it makes the Sabbath a difficult day. But if you happen to, while you're waiting, fall in and it's refreshing, you can stay fell in.
Yeah.
And yet I had some friends who were pastors' kids who the minute they got out of the house, they left because the father made sure that the three girls in the family stayed in their dresses until sundown at 8:30 in the evening. Yeah. And they lived on the same river. It was in their backyard, and they had to wait for the Sabbath to be over.
Get him.
You know, there's nothing wrong with sharing with someone the truth, but it's how you share it, how you present it. when I was young, single man, and I was completely violating the rules of Christianity in so many ways. I was just absolutely living in darkness. And one of my siblings came out and he goes, "You're going to burn in hell. You broke this, you broke this, you broke this. You have no place in heaven. You're breaking your mom's heart." And then as I'm walking away with anger, even more determined to walk away from God, my mother reached out to me with gentle hands, reached out to me real quick before I leave the driveway. She hugged me, she kissed me, she said, "Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you." She repeated it a couple of times. That just diffused the anger in my heart against God, which was not God's mistake. It was my ego, my personal feeling couldn't handle what my brother told me. So it's all in the presentation. We can bring people to the truth through gentleness. Christ is a soothing, the message of Christ is a soothing message of love and kindness. And through love and kindness, we can move mountains. We can bring people to his kingdom.
And I think that's the key. I think it's just really focusing on loving people. And how you love people is recognizing the love, the matchless love that what God did on the cross for us. Mm-hmm. He was the king of the universe. So after he died, when he rose from the grave, he said, you know, people say, oh, the prince of darkness rules the world. But what he said when he to his disciples was, I have now the authority. God has given me the authority over heaven and earth. Mm-hmm. And so we can claim that from Jesus.
Amen.
Right. And Pastor Etchell gave us that key. It's Jesus. Mm-hmm. What he has done, and not what we do.
Absolutely.
There was a minister's daughter who got into drugs, and she was talking with me. She says, "Dr. Taylor, from 9 to 5, my day is okay. But from 5 to 9, I need help." I can't put on my calling card as the pastor, office hours 9 to 5. My mama might decide to die at 3 o'clock or 2 o'clock in the morning. Do I have to wait until 9? The ministry of Jesus, he died to give us that power, and that's that focus that changed the world. Jesus died for you and for me. I thank God for it.
Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Taylor. And you know, there's never enough time when Pastor Mark Etchell is a guest on Christian Connection. This conversation can go on for another hour, but unfortunately, we're just down to the last 30 seconds or so. So let's give Gannon the last word here on Christian Connections.
Oh, we got to share the day of Jesus, the day that Jesus died for all of us. We need to share that with love and kindness and give people hope and something to look forward to than rather condemning others. So I look forward to the day when all of us believers can share Christ in everywhere we go.
See you next time.